Welcome to Sacred Awakenings, a community that supports spiritual exploration in order to awaken our greatest potential. Our Sunday gatherings are a time we set aside for ritual and ceremony as a community to enrich our own spiritual lives with the support of other open-hearted people. 3 weeks ago, we had Reverend Nicole, Losie starting this series off with the topic, The Body is a Temple. Last week, we had Dr. Garry Smith continuing the series with the topic, The Mind is a Temple. And this week, we're rounding the series out with Don Woodring, and the topic is The Heart is a Temple. We also are very grateful to have John and Lori Lefevre Johnson with us all 3 weeks, inspiring us with their music. We welcome you as a part of our sacred circle. Let us take a moment to connect with our breath and set our intention. Coming together, we create a collective divine heartbeat. We affirm truth and peace abide here. We gather to remember and recognize the divine mystery within. In our sacred circle, we honor the awakenings of each spirit who enters.
A prayer from Garry Smith. O heavenly, divine, sacred source of life, open up my eyes to see your divine presence in all of life. Open up my ears to hear your guidance as I move through the maze of this life. Lead me to act in the highest good of all concerned. Open up my heart to set aside judgment and to find and act with innocence in all things. Help me to realize greater gratitude for the divine blessings bestowed upon me. See within my heart the intention to serve the glory of the divine in each moment of the day. Thy will be done. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Amen.
But a song we sing, fear's the way we die. You can make the mountains ring or make the angels cry. Though the dove is on the
Thank you, Lori and John. That is a beautiful song that fits in with the temple of the heart. Everybody get together and love one another. So grateful for your gifts in music. So, welcome everybody to this Sacred Awakenings talk. Today we are finishing up a three-part series, and today is Heart as a Temple. We started a couple of weeks ago, and the videos are still available on the podcast and on Facebook and YouTube and our website. They're wonderful, wonderful messages in this series. The first one started with Reverend Nicole Losie, and she spoke about body as a temple. And she shared a beautiful message about being connected in and aligned with our true body needs, its full beingness and its wisdom as a sacred temple where the soul lives and experiences life. And she gave a great reminder that our bodies are literally made of stardust from across the galaxies. And ended with a great meditation on supporting you and really getting in touch and knowing yourself as the temple of the body. And then the second one was last week with Dr. Garry Smith, and he spoke on the temple of the mind and how with our mind's awareness, we can choose to be aware of what's going on and to be aware of our thoughts and our belief systems and how they affect all areas of our life. He shared about being responsible in a different way for our choices and how we can see ourselves fully, all of ourselves, and choose love always. So today, all of these three are so interconnected. We can't really have one without the other two, as a life on this beautiful planet Earth. And no one of the three is more important than the others. They all speak to each other. They all connect. They're all a part of the wholeness that we are, each are. And treating each one as a temple, as offering our devotion to all aspects of ourselves, our spirit, our mind, our body, that devotion to our journey of remembering all that we are, that is what brings the highest and brightest experiences in living a fulfilling life. So that journey of awakening and remembering the truth of who we are, it's often sparked by openings felt in the heart. I know both Nicole and Garry spoke about openings also. Some can come from illness or from emotional experiences that are linger in your mindset and your way of believing. But that heart opening that is felt can also be felt in a physical experience. That emotion of the heart opening, sometimes it feels literally like our heart is cracking open, or there's so much expansion happening, it feels like our heart is going to burst out of our body. Sometimes the heart openings come with an emotion that is, you know, you can be moved to tears by anything, by a commercial or by seeing another brother or sister in this human life in need, or seeing their joy, or whatever it is that touches into that open heart and sparks forth that connection and openness, that compassion for oneself and for others. Feeling it more fully and knowing that all of us are on our journeys together here, and we're all supporting each other in many, many, many ways, even when we're not aware of it. So since these heart openings, they're unique for each one of us, we all have our own souls livening these minds and these bodies, and all of us are having, all of us as souls are came here with such joy and such excitement to be a part of this wonderful thing called life on planet Gaia, planet Earth. Sometimes when our souls are giving us messages all the time, they can come through the heart, they can come through the body and the mind. And, oh, my light just went off. And these messages are always there for us. We in our practice of our our devotion to ourselves and to our journeys, we practice the opening up and the allowing for these messages to come through. Allowing that space for quiet, for us to know, to hear, to see things from soul. Sometimes when these messages come through or these heart openings happen, it's hard to tell the story of them, or it's hard to make sense of it, because they really can change your whole perception of yourself or of the world. And oftentimes they're best described by art or some creative endeavor, like the music that's shared in our Sunday gatherings or all over the place. April is National Poetry Month, and I was inspired to find a collection of poems that really speak to honoring ourselves, honoring our heart as a temple, and our journey of awakening, our journey of remembering, our journey of leading the most wonderful, fulfilling, joyful life that we can create for ourselves here. And since I have experiences with my own, and I've shared them in many Sunday talks, today I would like to share some from poets throughout the ages. So, most of these books poems can be found in a book that I have. It's called The Enlightened Heart, and it is a collection of poems gathered by Stephen Mitchell. And you can get it on Amazon Kindle or hard copy. It's a wonderful collection. So one of the first qualities when we are honoring ourselves and our heart as a temple, one of the qualities is that open-heartedness I talked about, and just allowing the love to flow and allowing the changes that that love makes in your life. So the first poem is from King David. It's from the Book of Psalms that can be found in the Christian Bible. And it's believed that King David wrote these psalms anywhere from the few centuries. What I saw was between the 8th and the 3rd century BC, which is quite a long period of time. But here's the first one, Psalm 1. Blessed are the man and the woman who have grown beyond their greed and have put an end to their hatred and no longer nourish illusions. But they delight in the way that things are, and they keep their hearts open day and night. They are like trees planted near flowing rivers, which bear fruit when they are ready. Their leaves will not fall or wither. Everything they do will succeed. So from that open-heartedness, the other quality that came forth that what I know of is a peace from soul that is really the soul's natural way. The soul does not live in a state of turmoil. There's always peace, no matter what's happening in the world, in the inner experiences and the outer experiences. There's this presence of peace and connectedness. And Lao Tzu, who was a Taoist master in China in the 6th century BC, he wrote a poem, or he wrote this. This is an excerpt. Empty your mind of all thoughts. Let your heart be at peace. Watch the turmoil of beings, but contemplate their return. Each separate being in the universe returns to the common source. Returning to the source is serenity. If you don't realize the source, you stumble in confusion and sorrow. When you realize where you come from, you naturally become tolerant, disinterested, amused, kind-hearted as a grandmother, dignified as a king. Immersed in the wonder of Tao, you can deal with whatever life brings you. And when death comes, you are ready. So this peace that's felt within, it often felt first in the heart, but it's a presence that can be throughout your whole beingness. And this peace can transform anything that shows up, like Lao Tzu spoke of. It can transform grief and pain and sorrow. And it doesn't happen by dismissing any of these feelings. It's only by embracing them, allowing the presence of whatever it is in your life with wonder at what gifts these experiences may bring. All of the experiences, all of these emotions or thoughts or anything, they pass when we loosen our grip on things. There's a natural flow of them, and you can allow them with practice just to move forward. And I found an excerpt from the Bhagavad Gita that speaks of this beautifully. The Gita is the central text in Hindu religion. And in this portion, Krishna is speaking as the I, and he is speaking as the embodiment of God. There is no personalness in this I. It is the divine. I am the radiance of the sun. I open or withhold the rain clouds. I am immortality and death. I am being and non-being. I am the self, Arjuna, seated in the heart of every creature. I am the origin, the middle, and the end that all must come to. Those who worship me sincerely with their minds and their bodies, giving up their whole lives in devotion, find me in their heart's fulfillment. Even those who do not know me, if their actions are straightforward, just, loving, venerate me with the truest kind of worship. All your thoughts, all your actions, all your fears and disappointments, offer them to me, clear-hearted. Know them all as passing visions. I am justice, clear, impartial, favoring no one, hating no one. But in those who have cured themselves of selfishness, I shine with brilliance. Even murderers and rapists, tyrants, the most cruel fanatics, ultimately, no redemption through my love, if they surrender to my harsh but healing graces. Passing through excruciating transformations, they find freedom, and their hearts find peace within them. I am always with all beings. I abandon no one. And however great your inner darkness, you are never separate from me. Let your thoughts flow past you calmly. Keep me near at every moment. Trust me with your life, because I am you, more than you yourself are. That beautiful presence that always is, always here, always within us and everyone. One aspect of it, or one presentation of it, is love. This love that is eternal, that is unconditional, that is ever present. So the Persian mystic and poet, Her name is Bibi Hayati. She was married to the head of one of the Sufi orders, and her husband encouraged her to record her poetry. And here is one of her poems. It was translated by Jane Hirschfield. And this speaks of that love, that eternal love that we always are. Before there was a trace of this world of men, I carried the memory of a lock of your hair, a stray end gathered within me, though unknown. Inside that visible, invisible realm, your face like the sun longed to be seen, until each separate object was finally flung into vision. From the moment of time's first drawn breath, love resides in us. A treasure locked into the heart's hidden vault. Before the first seed broke open the rose bed of being, an inner lark roared through your meadows, heading towards home. What can I do but thank you 100 times? Your face illumines the shrine of Hayati's eyes, constantly present and lovely. It's beautiful. Your face illuminates the shrine of everyone's eyes, every set of eyes that you look into. It's illuminated by love. So I also explored some of the different aspects of this love in a human life on this earth, and that rapture that is felt, that intense feeling of connection and desire and oneness, and that can come in physical expressions and divine expressions and the emotional and all sorts of ways. And so I included an excerpt from a poem from Walt Whitman, the American poet. I mind how we lay in June, such a transparent summer morning. You settled your head athwart my hips and gently turned over upon me, parted the shirt from my bosom bone and plunged your tongue into my bare-stripped heart, and reached until you felt my beard, and reached until you held my feet. Swiftly arose and spread around me the peace and the knowledge that pass all argument on earth. And I know the hand of God is the elder hand of my own, and I know the Spirit of God is the eldest brother of my own, and that all the men ever born are also my brothers, and the women are my sisters and lovers, and that a kelson of the creation is love, and limitless are leaves stiff or drooping in the fields, and brown ants in the little wells beneath them, and mossy scabs of the worm fence, and heap stones, and elder, and mullein, and pokeweed. I so love that. His beautiful description of love and nature and oneness. So this brought me to another quality that I found so beautifully expressed by a Japanese monk, poet, and Zen master, Ryokan. It's that childlike wonder. It's that joy in everything that is touched, when our hearts are open, when we honor that presence, that wonder and that joy, the curiosity, the play is just present. It's so natural. So here's one of his poems. He lived in the later half of the 1700s and the early 1800s. First days of spring, the sky is bright blue, the sun huge and warm, everything's turning green. Carrying my monk's bowl, I walk to the village to beg for my daily meal. The children spot me at the temple gate and happily crowd around, dragging at my arms until I stop. I put my bowl on a white rock and hang my bag on a branch. First we braid grasses and play tug-of-war. Then we take turns singing and keeping a kickball in the air. I kick the ball and they sing, they kick and I sing. Time is forgotten, the hours fly. People passing by point at me and laugh. Why are you acting like such a fool? I nod my head and don't answer. I could say something, but why? Do you want to know what's in my heart? From the beginning of time, just this. Just this. So love the joy and playfulness that is in his poetry. And the way he talks about playfulness, it also speaks to that oneness that we all are, that connectedness and that beauty. So for that one, I chose a poem that also connects in with peace that I spoke of in the beginning. It's called Pax by D.H. Lawrence, the English novelist and essayist. Pax. All that matters is to be at one with the living God, to be a creature in the house of the God of life. Like a cat asleep on a chair, at peace, in peace, and at one with the master of the house, with the mistress, at home. At home in the house of the living, sleeping on the hearth, and yawning before the fire. Sleeping on the hearth of the living world, yawning at home before the fire of life, feeling the presence of the living God like a great reassurance, a deep calm in the heart. A presence, as of the master sitting at the board in his own and greater being in the house of life. And for the final one that wraps it up, that temple, the true temple, are not found anywhere in the external. The true temple is within us. It's the experience that I know of as Christ consciousness. When we turn our focus from the external world to the inner world and let go of any need for validation from others, we come to know ourselves as spirit, as soul, and honor ourselves as that, as truth, as worthy, as divine individuals, part of this whole creation, and that each one of us matters. We each play a part. So this last poem is from a German poet and priest. His name was Johann Scheffler, but he wrote under the pseudonym Angelus Silesius, if I'm pronouncing that, who knows, in an American way. So this poem is, "It Depends on You." If in your heart you make a manger for his birth, then God will once again become a child on earth. This I've found is the most beautiful, simple message of living Christ consciousness. I'll say it one more time. It depends on you. If in your heart you make a manger for his birth, then God will once again become a child on earth. This is what blossoms in our heart as the temple. So I invite you all to a practice with me. And in this practice, perhaps some of your own inner heart's poetry may come forth. So sit if you're not. I invite you to sit and close your eyes if you're comfortable, or lower your gaze. Bring your awareness to your breath and notice, just notice how it moves. Feel in your body how it is supported right now, however it sits. Notice what's going on within your mind. No need to attach to any of those movements, just allow them to be. Allow everything to be and to just move. There's no need to control or change anything. And bring your awareness to your heart area. You may even want to place your hand there and feel that connection. Invite in the peace of you as soul, the natural feeling that soul embodies in your heart area. Allow yourself to be in the quiet stillness of the temple of your heart. Feel the devotion of your own life force, your soul's devotion to supporting this life that you're living. Feel that devotion to the interconnectedness, of you, your mind, your body, your soul, your heart, the spirit of you. Allow your heart's temple to expand. Allow it to expand beyond you, connecting in with the heart of all life, the love that is present all around, the holiness and sacredness of all creation. This is you. And you are this. Bring your awareness back into you in your heart area, back in your broad body. Notice what is present now in your experience. Bring your awareness back to your breath and where you are sitting. And when you are ready, open your eyes. I thank you all, and I will turn it back over to Lori and John.
Though I may speak with bravest fire and have gift to all inspire,
Considering our message, our music, our meditation, and all that Sacred Awakenings offers the community that gathers, we ask that you consider a love offering or energy exchange at our website, sacredawakenings.org. Please join me in this blessing. Divine love, through me, blesses and multiplies all that I have, all that I give, and all that I receive. Divine love, through us, blesses and multiplies all that we have, all that we give, and all that we receive. May your generosity you share with Sacred Awakenings continue to bless you with divine abundance and prosperity. Thank you.
I invite you all to join in a community blessing and holding of intention. We bring to our hearts those who are in our awareness, names that have been spoken aloud and in silence. Those to share in this energy, our friends, family members, community members, ourselves, and all our loved ones. We hold love in our hearts for each one, offering our love with compassion to uplift in whatever way serves the highest good for all. May we honor each living being as sacred and an important part of the whole. May we remember and honor the gift that is this life, offering our devotion to the temples of our body, our mind, and heart. May we play in the divine flow of peace and joy present with each moment. And so it is.
Thank you so much, Dawn, John, and Lori, for making this week's gathering so uplifting and inspiring. Please stay for the discussion after and join us next week. Re-listen to our podcast or re-watch this on Facebook. Also, check out our website at sacredawakenings.org. May every day bring you Sacred Awakenings.
Just wait and see. Another day goes by and still the children cry. Put a little love in your heart. You want the world to know. You won't let hatred grow. Put a little love in your heart. And the world will be a better place. And the world will be a better place. just wait and see. Take a good look around, and if you're looking down, put a little love in your heart. I hope when you decide, kindness will be your guide. Put a little love in your heart, and the world will be a better place. Yes, the world will be a better place for you and me. Just wait and see.
Please feel free at this time to take a moment to stretch your legs or perhaps refresh your drink, and we will be starting our discussion soon.